what it means in modern society later. And also what kind of future it has. I think everybody's experience of it now, if you don't know much about its past, is that it's become a bit of a pop icon. You know how things do, like robots and owls and skulls. You know, things come and go. It sort of becomes quite a fashionable thing. And I think certainly the value of it has changed a lot today compared to how it was valued by even monarchies, Western monarchies. So that prompted me to sort of look in a little bit further about what that actually means for its future. So after I saw the video, a couple of days later, I got an email from out of the blue from Alicia saying that she was doing this, planning this pop-up, and what she does, and that was just the strangest thing for that to have happened, and it was quite exciting. So we met and discussed what it was that she wanted, and what, you know, where she sees the future of this material, and also her company, and what she sees my involvement being. And this is the result. This is an example of taking something that I suppose is the assumption is that it's just a kind of fashionable pop icon, but it has such a rich future, and its future is going to become as rich as its history. So that's why I wanted to share a few words with you this evening, just to see whether I can inspire you in some way to look into it a bit more. Are any of you artists or designers? No?
Learning to be
what?
I'm at uni, studying fashion design.
Fashion design, okay. So what's your, what inspires you then?
I pretty much just go out and look around in London, you know,
yeah.
See what I find.
Yeah, it's perfect. That's the question that gets put to me quite a lot, I suppose, particularly for interviews, is what inspires you? It's actually a fairly difficult question to answer, although I just say the same thing every time, which is I'm inspired by everything, you have to be. But you don't have to be a designer or a creative to be inspired by everything and apply that to what you do. What do you guys do, can I ask?
Buyer.
Okay. Yeah, were yours just as relevant as hers?
I'm a physical therapist.
Okay. Well, the same applies. You still have contact with people. Yeah. It's still about communication. It's about sort of inspiring people to act positively, right? Essentially, because there's something. It doesn't matter what you do. You need to be inspired to do it properly, and to then inspire other people. And I think what's so lovely about the pineapple and evidently what we've created here in this collaboration is the connectivity of it. It's very exciting. And what do you do?
I just started on sustainability.
Wonderful. Excellent. Exactly. It's very relevant indeed. The benches that you're sitting on here. I've made from discarded pallets and then printed a pineapple graphic on it. The graphic is a pattern that I worked out from the pineapple skin, which is what the wall sculptures are as well. And this is just an example of a discussion that Alicia and I had about, okay, well, you know, it'd be nice to involve people in some way. What can we, should we just order some benches and, you know do a talk or something like that? And originally I just said, yeah, okay, we were going to rent them, weren't we? We were going to rent some benches. And then it got me thinking, okay, well, do I have enough time to make some myself, and how would I make them? And that whole process was really nice too, because I tried out a few different things. I worked with cardboard quite a lot, a lot of paper, but that stock and support was weight, so what do I do? And it had to be fairly cheap to make, and not too time consuming. So this was an exercise of just trying to apply that kind of handcrafted care and the thought behind producing something that has a function. It's an art piece, but it has a function, and that's what. an experience. It's experience. It's not just a picture on the wall. So, and what about you, Tim?
I'm a fashion management student. We're focused on luxury and production.
Okay. Luxury and production. Okay. Is there? Do you have any interest in sustainable practices? Or?
Actually, I'm writing my research project at the moment, and I'm researching natural substitutes in luxury fashion.
Okay.
I spoke with Alicia on the phone, so about this already. I'm really interested in this. So, yeah.
It really hasn't been long since I've even known about it myself, so it's incredible actually. Are you guys familiar with the other products the other brands that are here with that use being sex?
Not really.
It's becoming something that will challenge the norm of wasteful fashion. It's so important today that's addressed. I think the fashion industry at the moment, the wastefulness is—I don't think really people understand the levels that it's gone to. So this is an example of people that are trying to work sustainably and inspire others to do the same. What do you guys do?
Well, so I study fashion, visual merchandising, and branding. And last year, I've done my final project with Pineflex, which marketing company that we support introduced. Capsule collection with the Pineflex timeless pieces like leather jacket, bullet, etc.
Okay. Were you aware of what was involved in this at all?
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
Well, okay.
So what do you make of it in here? What if you obviously you're aware of what's going on in here, and the kind of brands and things that are involved. But in your impression of what, how does it come across? Like what's your first impression when you come in here?
It's good. I mean, it's simple. I think that simplicity is like, it's key. Like,
in a kind of a less small.
Like, you have power, so.
Sure, yeah.
So it's clear, like, you can't like, just see the pieces.
Yeah, okay.
Is there any connection with the Fashion Revolution Week? Because the Fashion Revolution Week is running.
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Yep.
That's,
yes.
That was something that was at the forefront of having it
yeah.
go on right now. Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. It's definitely a sort of a calendar event. I think something like this, it's important to put it on a date where people are aware of what's going on in the industry. I used to work in fashion set design, so I'm also very familiar with how wasteful the industry can be. I used to go on jobs where there would be you'd make an entire set for photographic stills, and then afterwards the entire set would be thrown away, and that used to just break my heart a bit. But obviously job security says, okay, just ignore that. You know, don't sort of step up and say this is wrong. Just get on with it. That's your job. But then it got to a point where I wanted to kind of exercise my own interest and work in a different way. And this is why I use paper a lot. I'm a trained illustrator. It's what I did at university, but since working with a fashion set designer as an assistant, I started to think a lot more three-dimensionally, which is why my work just got exploded into three dimensions. I have a lot of clients contacting me to do jobs, and they have this grand idea that they want it made out of, you know, acrylic or sort of metals and stuff, and I always manage to persuade them to let me make things out of paper. I think the common misconception is that paper is so it can't support itself, it's perishable, and yes it is, but it is a legitimate sculptural medium, and you can achieve, visually you can achieve anything that with paper that you can achieve with any other material. So, were you aware that once the pineapple was managed to be brought back to the UK, how obviously the botanist societies they tried to cultivate the pineapple but miserably failed for a long time, and there weren't any answers for such a long time. When they eventually did get the formula right. They went to the extremes of having to actually have chambers underneath the soil and stoke fires just to keep the perfect temperature so that the plant could grow. And there was a job for somebody to actually stoke the fires in order to just keep the pineapple alive, which was extraordinary. I don't know if you're aware, if you've been to any palaces in this country where you've seen any pineapples on the gateposts. Anybody? It became such an icon, and it's extraordinary really how it has changed over time. Even though those pineapples and those gateposts still exist, you only have to walk around Shoreditch or around town just to go into any kind of shop where they'll have pineapples printed on t-shirts on pencil cases, you know, earrings, and so the value of it has changed extraordinarily. So it still holds a lot of value, I mean, it's still making people money, but it's very accessible. You can go into any shop and buy a pineapple and eat it, and you know, you wouldn't really think anything of where it came from or what the potential of this future is. And I noticed that there's a lot of you guys are working in fashion. I think last night we had our launch, which was a really nice evening. I was speaking to a lot of people about the effect that it can have in changing the way that we use materials and how it affects the people that actually make those things. So they're the people right back to the farmers who actually grow pineapples. How they can actually benefit more from working with a material like this and supplying it for the fashion industry and actually benefit from it, get something more from it than what a lot of farmers and a lot of makers of materials. They suffer from you know, very, very low income. And so it's I was speaking to the lady who I think runs PNTX, right?
Carmen?
Yeah. You know, they're very inspiring ladies, and they you know, what's very important to them is making sure that everybody that's involved in making this material you know, they get out of it what they deserve to get out of it. And it's important that the practice is ethical. And it's nice for me to be working with Alicia, because that's I think it's important to work with people that also inspire you and are working in the right ways. So you guys are currently you know, currently learning and involved in things to work with sustainability. Are you guys in together? Are you friends?
Yeah.
Okay. So is that something that you feel like you want to apply to your future practice? Working in this way?
You mean sustainability?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. So give me an example of the kind of people that you might work with when you leave university. So are you going to be creating collections, or are you going to be working with people in order to source materials for the designers, or what?
No, I haven't yet decided.
Okay. What would you like to do?
Probably collections.
To make collections.
Yeah.
Okay. It's an interesting thing. I'm so curious just on how you don't have to know what you want to do exactly. I mean, you know, some of the most interesting people I've ever met, I still don't know what they want to do in their 40s. And seriously. But I think it is important to start thinking differently, because I think just the way society is, you can get yourself into a pattern and you're given a lot of information, and some things you just go unnoticed. You know, simple things like recycling. You know, you drink the contents of the bottle, and you throw it away, or you put it in the recycling, you forget about it. You have no idea where it goes. Nobody really considers that, do they? Let's be honest. So I think it's important to really think about who you're working with and what materials you're using. So I'm currently working on a new collection. These pineapple sculptures here are two of five, and they're 100% paper, and this paper one over here is made up of marble paper. Are you guys familiar with marbling? It's a very, very old practice. It was usually paper that was made to cover books. which is such a beautiful handcrafted practice itself. And it was, and this one here is a dalgam, which is, it's the most popular one. I mean, dalgam pineapples are, yeah, they're everywhere now, but they certainly were represented in that way in history. And so this collection represents it's a celebration of their historical values. So my next collection is going to be about the discovery of values and the discovery of self. So what is value? Why do people value things? And what do values actually mean? And it's a very personal thing, value. Everybody has their own value. And something like gold has become, you know, it's just a stone, it's just something that's got pulled out of the ground, and it's become one of the most valuable things on the planet. But that's only become that way through a personal decision by a group of people to bring it back and say that this is the most wonderful thing on Earth. We all have our independent values. And have you ever thought about how you value things and what, you know, personal things? There's a monetary value for sure, but there's also emotional value. There's cultural values where a group of people would value something. I was working with a Filipino lady, ceramicist. She was doing something for me for a concert space, and I kind of just cockily said, you know, pineapples are a symbol of hospitality, and you know, and then she said, oh yeah, where? What, to who? And she didn't care at all, and then that sort of made me think, okay, I'm kind of doing the textbook thing and saying, you know, yeah, they're the symbol of hospitality, and yes, they are on some level, and from history, but that's only to Western cultures. It's not. I mean, to the Filipinos, that's means something very different. It's still something that is celebrated, and you know, and it's still something that is shared. For gatherings and where people connect, it is a celebrative thing that shared, but it doesn't mean the same thing all over the world. So values. Why did they go to such lengths to bring the pineapple back? Now you can understand that from a botanical discovery perspective. You know, learning about the planet that you're on. And learning about you know where it comes from, the place that it comes from, and the people that are from where the pineapple is from, or where anything is discovered, the people that actually are from that place. Learning about all of the fruits of this planet are really important. You can understand that from the botanical. And so the bringing it back to the UK to try and cultivate it, that's also understandable. You know, it's just human interest to try and work out how to do it, and that's wonderful in itself. I mean, the amount of records involved even you know, like the Natural History Museum. Have you guys been down to the basement where they have all the glass specimen jars of all number of creatures they've discovered and just put in vinegar water and you know, to preserve them. It's a human fascination to understand the planet that we're on, and also try to understand each other and the way that we all work. So I think that's why it's such an interesting thing, that it's almost been forgotten about a bit, but almost kind of reinvented itself by becoming such a sort of a poppy icon. I don't know any other example that that's happened. Can you guys think about something other than a pineapple where that's happened? The extremes that it's gone.
What was the question again? Sorry.
I wanted to find out whether anybody can give an example like the pineapple where it's gone from such a rare and extraordinary and valuable item to such a sort of a low value pop icon where it's just such an accessible.
Oh, okay.
But isn't it the same with diamonds, for example?
Not at all. Diamonds are accessible, but they're certainly not.
You can easily create something that's almost the same.
But it's an interesting thing. I mean that in itself will. I mean that will drop the value of anything once they replication.
Yeah.
And I think that's the thing about the London industry. It's all about quick replication, as cheap as possible.
As quick as possible.
Can you say technology as well? Because in the past it wasn't so accessible when it just started, but now obviously it's accessible to everyone.
Yeah, the technology is a.
It's a vast
umbrella but you're right. I mean, it's amazing how that's kind of developed and so quickly and how accessible it is.
Just back in the day, rice was really tough to yield, like hand picking rice.
Yeah.
And now, obviously, like farms, like a huge system to yield a ton of rice. So,
yeah.
Ancient China, rice was really a different lab, like big mounds of it, and shared it with your family and friends that were wealthy.
Yeah, absolutely.
And
how
now,
important was it? So those people, I mean, it was incredibly important food source. Imagine that the rice didn't exist.
Right.
You know, obviously, there would probably be other things. But rice is incredibly important. But even now, it's really important. But you're right. It's the accessibility has changed. And so how what's your relationship with that thing now? It's really nice that everything's so accessible. But it also loses value. You don't really you take it for granted, don't you? Really? Isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
If you don't agree, then please. Please say. I'm really very happy to disagree. Anybody think of anything else? Something that perhaps held a lot of value, but has almost lost its value or changed its value.
Chocolate, maybe.
Potentially. I mean, trade. This is a whole part of it, really, because the trade lines between the West and China, particularly. I mean, that was incredibly important. The trade of spices, the trade of foods, and the pineapple ended up getting taken to Hawaii, where it's, you know, it's booming now. It got taken to China, it got taken to Africa. I mean, the Philippines and Costa Rica, for example, are pretty much the top two, I think, for pineapple production. Nigeria, I think, is number three. It's incredible, actually, the fact that they are, even though they're probably the biggest producers, they can't export any of it. There's metric tons upon tons upon tons of pineapples produced in Nigeria, but they can't export any of them. And, you know, there's a lot of farmers that are missing out there. But mostly, when you cut a pineapple, you know, the leaf, even though it's sort of, you know, cactus looking and it's interesting, it just gets discarded. And that is such a beautiful thing, that the material that will now become valuable to somebody can be made from waste products. And that's really the next part that I, you know, would like to discuss is the future of it. What kind of influence does it have on people? What influence could it have on you guys that are researching fashion? Not just aesthetically and sculpturally, which is how I work with it. This I've got so much stuff going on in my head that I want to exercise and share with people in the future. And it's all about the journey. It's the past, present, and future of the Bible. The fashion industry is just one industry that it can affect in a huge way. For the obvious reasons, this kind of the development of this material is just the start, I hope. But architecturally, it's been used by the patination of it. It started to be used by architects, craftsmen, and artisans like motifs for their buildings. And part of the project that I'm working on next involves architecture and how people can be inspired by it to create the buildings that people live in, the people that walk into the buildings. You're affected by the room that you walk into, no? The buildings that you walk into, they give you a feeling. Nobody has to be in that building particularly. If you walk into a building, you either know that you want to be there or you don't want to be there. And it's incredibly powerful thing, architecture. So
But again, it's like the use of materials in the future. I mean, maybe Inditex could develop something that can actually go into making buildings. Fibrous material, very strong fibrous material that can be bonded with building material in order to make a space. I think that's perfectly possible. Do you think that would be possible? Say if you don't, if you think that that's just waffling.
What is the broccoli, like the racial thing?
The Roman broccoli?
Yeah.
I would encourage you to look it up on Google. It's an extraordinary thing. It's basically, it is a broccoli, but it's like a cross between a broccoli and a cauliflower. It's just that each of the florets spins, it's got a patinated spin, and it's the most incredible swirling fetching of an organic object. I had an Italian photographer come to an exhibition of mine, and he said, the pineapple is beautiful, but it's nowhere near as beautiful as the Roman broccoli. And he showed me a picture. I said, what the hell is a Roman broccoli? And he pulled the picture out and he showed it to me. And I was like, wow, I'm now stuck between a Roman broccoli and a pineapple. I should change my direction. But things like that, I mean, you don't have to be an artist, you don't have to be a mathematician, you don't have to be anybody to really appreciate the quality of that. Nature is an extraordinary thing, and I think anything that inspires you that is natural is extremely healthy. Remind me what you do again?
Communications.
Okay, so who do you communicate with, and what way? Like, what do you share with people? How do you get people excited?
It's more like I think do more like linguistics. I deal with a lot of cross-cultural differences in communication.
Amazing. No, that's great. That's good. Connectivity.
Yeah.
With everybody, not just a certain type of person. And the things that you share, how do you communicate, what exactly do you communicate to these people? I'm just interested, if you don't mind.
Do you, what I communicate?
Yeah.
With
who? Everybody. What is the nature of what you're talking to these people about?
depends who the person I'm talking to is.
Okay. Yes. Can you give me an example?
You mean like with friends?
For your profession, I mean, so if you can give me an example of how you connect with people within your professional environment and what it is that you talk to them about. Does that make sense?
I guess I try to find like a mutual interest.
A solution? Mutual, okay. Elaborate a little bit if you can.
I'm not quite sure if I understand like the point of the question, like
it's quite... I'm talking about connectivity, so we're talking about, you know, inspiring other people about certain things, belief systems that you might have, things that inspire you and you share with other people. So it doesn't matter what you do within your profession.
Mm.
Like I'm here, I'm attempting, I hope I'm winning very slightly, but I'm attempting to inspire you in some
so
kind
you
of
how
way.
To influence people.
Yes, how to influence other people positively and also be passionate about what it is that you do.
Yeah, so I guess if I want to convince people about something, I try to relate it to something that might interest them as well or something that might benefit them as well, because then they're going to listen.
Okay, so you tailor it to them, but does what you're talking about really excite you?
Depends.
Okay.
But I have to. I think we always have to relate it to the audience, because otherwise they will be interested in
what I'm telling them. I'm really interested because you know, a lot of people have asked me about what's your talk about, and I would say about pineapples.
Yeah.
And you know, of course, you know, the first thought is pineapples again.
Yeah.
You know, and that's understandable. I mean, the pineapple is just a pineapple. But is it? There's people that are changing the direction of the pineapple again, and it's becoming something that is incredibly positive for the future. And so that's what I'm talking about. It's you don't have to leave here loving pineapples. You don't have to be inspired by what I'm saying necessarily, but it might unlock something in the way that you connect with people and the way that you inspire them, because that's really what it's all about. And that's why I wanted to try and share something with you. I've committed myself to working with Pineapple. It's not just to make pretty pictures. It's about communicating something bigger. The future is quite exciting, and the potential is very exciting. So with Pineapples and with the people that are working with them and working with them sustainably and affecting other cultures, but affecting other people that are also involved in that process.
So what you're trying to communicate mainly is the sustainability.
It's
a symbol of this.
It's the connectivity of the Pineapple. It's that everybody's involved. It's not a demographic specific thing. I'm not just in it to make pictures and sell them. I'm much less of a businessman than I am just a passionate artist in what I do. But the reason why I'm working with them now, and the reason why I'm going to be still working with them in the future, is because of the richness of their potential. Mm. And I find already that it's highly connective. There were some very inspiring people here last night talking about that they're working with Pineapples in the same way, but in a different way, if you know what I mean. They're working with Pineapples because they've seen something, they've seen the potential in it, but they're working with it, within their industry. I think it's just important. So whatever it is that you discover, that you are passionate about, whatever it is that you share, that you want to share with people in any capacity, I think it's really important for everybody to kind of understand where that material comes from, and then if you're working with people that are interested, also maybe they might not know much about the material they're working with, but it's also it is very important to understand the industry that you're in and where it's going in the future, I think. Does anybody have any questions?
Sure.
What are your thoughts on, I guess what's resonating with me more is this, the sustainability portion of it, and how you can use portions of the Pineapple to create fashionable products and other things, possibly like buildings.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on the sustainability and then the trend of people having more of a minimalistic lifestyle in North America, especially, and then also in Europe?
In what context?
So with like minimalism, it's like lower amounts of stuff that you own, clothing or even home, but higher quality of it. So is there a balance that you're going to strike in your mind, I guess, if you look forward to the future of sustainable, good Pineapple byproduct, I can't remember what the name was, and minimalism?
That's a very interesting question. I think people today are, I suppose everybody knows that we've all got the potential to hoard, to collect objects that we don't need. The vast majority of those objects are plastic, aren't they? I'm working on a conservation project about ocean conservation, about the state of the oceans and the amount of plastic that ends up in the ocean. So it's going to be a sculptural piece about that. So, but to answer your question, I think through understanding the material that you're working with, but also everybody has key things that they need in life. There's always going to be things that people want, all the time. And there's always going to be people there's always going to be industry that rolls that out. But I think everybody that I speak to, at least, has a desire to have less. They realise that they've got too much stuff. Everybody knows that. I mean, the fashion industry is only one example of that. It's industry throughout. I think everybody has a desire to have less and to be in a clearer space. This was a huge space to fill. Now, we wanted it to be a space that people could walk into and not feel, that it was in their face. I mean, have enough space to walk around and actually consider and touch the materials and consider the space. And it was initially it was difficult for me to think about how to fill this space, but
people working with the penis sex in this way. I mean, like I said, it's just the start. I think the question is, what do we do with all the stuff that we don't want? What do you do with it? I mean, it's become something that you can't just.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
I can just say a connection with shared economy. Have you ever heard about this? Within the
shared
economy.
Right.
That we are going to render things, not just cars, but we are going to render clothes in order to produce less. So
oh,
it could
amazing.
Be an answer for this,
exactly.
To have less shared
yeah.
economy.
Yeah. So
and in Scandinavia, it worked quite pretty well, and H&M started to render clothes in Sweden.
Sure.
In Europe, we are not people.
It's an interesting concept.
Yeah,
it is. I have no idea how that would work, but I think it's something that you have to welcome, right?
What is it called? Shared economy,
or
spiral economy.
Shared?
Shared.
Oh, I see.
From sharing.
I mean, it's a strange concept, isn't it? Renting clothes.
Well, there's like rent the runway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Creating the
runway.
Runway.
Renting things. You know, they have to exist to start with. Let's understand that. Let's exist to start with, but then still, what do you do with what already exists? You know, there's.
Recycle.
Okay, but not everything can be recycled at the moment, which is heartbreaking.
But if we switch to the mode of shared economy, so let's say that roughly in 100 years we could be fine. We will recycle everything in this time.
Mm.
The thing is humanity is not prepared, because this economy is about the ownership, which is connected with the social status. So
yeah.
We still think if I own something, it means that this is my social status.
Exactly.
And I'm connected to the social class.
Exactly.
So we need to switch to the shared economy and not being fixed to the owning things.
Owning an object, which
yeah,
makes
because
you
in this economy, the more you have, the better person probably you are.
Exactly.
It's
the way society is. I suppose that's kind of what I'm getting at is what do you value and why? It's something that I've been looking at quite a lot lately, and everything that I'm trying to do, I'm trying to consider that exact thing. I mean, my relationship with fashion has changed quite a lot. My wife works in corporate fashion, and she works for a company that. They care. They don't care one little squidgen about sustainability or anything. And so she's made the decision to leave the company because they don't fit her. She wants to work with people that actually consider that. She's actually very very good. She's looking forward to meeting Alicia actually, just to find out a bit more about you know, the way that she works, because I think it's important to be connected to people that are prepared to take that step. And work in that way. Do you guys have conversations about this with people already? I suppose you must already do, because you've just shared what you've just shared. Do you discuss this? I mean, am I saying anything that you don't know already?
Yes, I use an app called OLIO. So it's like an app that you exchange food. It's all for free, or like things that you don't need, you just exchange them for free. And whenever I get something from people, they invite me to their house and we talk about like how to actually like to have a more sustainable lifestyle. Like my friend actually gets grass from Wasabi at Liverpool Street all the time and eat them because it's actually fresh food. And
yeah.
It's actually really cool. Like,
I love Wasabi. It's amazing. But that's all. That's wonderful stuff. You know, I don't know whether you guys are aware. I mean, activism seems to sell more than sex these days. You get a lot of companies that are taking activist kind of steps into making their. For instance, Adidas has just started making the shoes out of ocean plastic waste, which it's really nice to see. I mean, obviously they're going to be making millions from doing that. But they've plugged into something that is important in society at the moment, which is seeing companies that work in a wasteful way, you know, consider how they work and changing that. Anybody?
Can I say something?
Yeah.
If you think about the H&M, they just launched the Conscious Collection, which is from the PET bottles or something like that. But if you think about the concept of the H&M, it's the global giant, and about the production, so this one, a recycled collection, is not going to
say anything, which is just ridiculous, because the H&M is promoting these days the recycled collection, we are conscious, and have a look at the production.
For sure.
Yeah.
So it's just ridiculous, it's just concept, just marketing concept.
Of course, that is powerful, it's powerful. I'm certainly not bowled over by it.
So I've seen the installation at Oxford Circus with the pet bottlers, and to me it was just ridiculous because they are not like...
They're just getting on bad way.
Yeah, it's just only good way how to attract millennials because we think more about like eco-friendly, sustainable products, and H&M knows it. That's why
they're
doing it.
And advertising
but
is
the real reason behind it is not sustainability, it's just making a profit. Which is again very sad because again we are in the beginning of the process, we are not making anything better.
No, for sure. Seeing that Adidas advert did make me think initially, wow, that's cool, but then who actually really knows, you know, how much of that shoe is made out of ocean waste and what's the process? I think it is starting to confuse people. They can see these massive corporations taking these sort of steps, but they are tapping into the way people are thinking now, and going to be making money as a result. So it's just the way industry is. But I think as individuals, yes, look.
Well, I was just going to say, I think that makes it really difficult as consumers to make the right decisions, because if you're being bombarded with these messages that you don't know what the truth behind the messages are, or to what extent the messages are true. Say, for example, I think in beauty products, to be branded as organic, they only need to have 1% of their ingredients to be organic.
Really?
I don't know if it's quite as low as that.
We're bombarded with that kind of information all the time, and this is a very strong point. It's that it's more than meets the eye. Everything is set out in around you. Your reality is what you see, right? Is it? It's everything around you. You see, you absorb, and it's all information that's given to you. It's all, everything's sort of advertised and shared in a way that you believe it. The information is given to you, you accept it, although you might question it yourself, you're not really going to do anything about it as an individual, are you? So it's a difficult society to work through. But I think as long as your head is in the right place and you're aware of the way things are done and how you can make a difference, that's really the important thing. I think the future of the pineapple, particularly for us, I mean, I'm just an artist, but I recently have kind of realised this thing a lot more. I really started to care about it, and I want to kind of make a difference in whatever way I can to affect things in for the better. So I'm working with a couple of charitable organisations in raising funds for projects of conservation. So I mean, when I first started creating art, I questioned whether I was ever going to be able to have any influence on conservation. I've always been a wildlife fanatic, and I always used to think that it was a rich man's game. If you didn't have any money, then there's no way that you can really affect conservation. Yeah, okay, you can volunteer and things, but I mean, you still generally volunteering projects. You still, the vast majority of them, you still have to pay in order to get there and to be involved. So. And then recently I kind of realised that there must be some way that I can use my art to affect conservation, to whether it be just raising money through the sale of art, or whether it can be expressing a message through the art to affect people to raise awareness. I'm still working that out, but I mean, this working with Alicia and being here is just one of those. It's just like a very small step in the right direction of working in a particular way, and not just making art just to sell and make a bit of money and that's it. And we can read pictures and the artwork that ends up on people's walls it makes them happy, and I'm very happy for that. But it's there's the potential for it to have a much greater impact in whatever way. So I'm working hard to try and work out.
So anybody have any more questions about